Part two of this four-part puzzle is out. And what do we do for this holiday season? That's right, we now have the official 13th gen Intel CPU announcement. This is a 12th gen, but point being is it does get a little bit more interesting now. Let's walk through Raptor Lake versus Ryzen 7000. So letting folks in on the landscape, the field of war when it comes to tech, Ryzen 5000 series and 12th gen have been battling it out over the last 8 months, with Intel currently taking the strategic victory over Ryzen 5000, which has been just kind of limping along for the past little while. But hark, from the bowels of the Silicon Cave, Ryzen spits forth its latest legend, the Ryzen 7000, and today in kind, Intel has responded with its Raptor Lake 13th generation processors. Well, at least they announced them. The AMD one is currently out and it's like swiping away at the grunts of PC gamers and workstation owners who are currently littering the landscape. That illustration became way darker than I thought. If you missed the news yesterday, we got the actual reviews of AMD Ryzen 7000 series CPUs, and frankly, the results were positive and mixed. So here's a quick recap. It's less of a crazy lead on the gaming side than we had anticipated, but crushes, and I do mean crushes, on the multi-threaded workloads. Also, AMD has a bit of an issue with this like smaller sleeper agent in the Ryzen 5800X 3D. That is essentially a better value and doesn't have all the high costs of moving over to a new platform with similar to sometimes even better gaming performance than the brand new CPUs. There's also some new cooling paradigms that folks need to consider in the way that these new AMD CPUs run hot intentionally, and how we, aka PC enthusiasts and owners, look at cooling and performance of these CPUs moving forward, at least on the higher end Ryzen 7000 CPUs. Lastly, there's like the whole value of upgrading, because it supports like all of the new tech and all of the new bling with stuff like DDR5, Jordan Dunks, and like PCIe Gen 5 Supreme hoodies, and all the hip and hype, which unfortunately costs more money and therefore brings down the overall value of upgrading. Especially on the gaming side, when the gains aren't really enough to warrant an upgrade for some, and you could spend far less on an aging, though pretty new still, 5800X 3D system. But let's talk about the announcement that happened today, because for many of you watching, this part is probably new. This morning at Intel's Innovate conference, during the keynote, we finally got our peek into Raptor Lake, or Intel's new 13th generation CPU. Okay, so let's go over the basics here. Today, Intel announced the successor of their new top tier CPUs today, in the form of like the 13900K, the 13700K, and the 13600K, along with the F models, meaning they don't have integrated graphics cards. Now, we didn't get the rest of the stack, but between mobile and desktop, there are going to be over 50 different variations of Intel's Raptor Lake CPUs. Now, just like Alder Lake, or 12th gen for people who don't want to remember lake names, Raptor Lake will have all of the P-core and E-core architecture stuff and all the same benefits from things like Thread Director and Windows 11 integration, whether you loved it or not. They did actually show some of this off with game developers and other content creation tools to show how you can game and do other tasks without impacting performance because of these P-cores and E-cores. Now, the P-cores, the ones that we actually care about for gaming, aren't really changing in quantity. The E-cores are actually going to be doubled across the family, meaning 24 cores, 32 threads for the 13900K, compared to 16 and 24 on the 12th gen 12900K. You got 16 cores and 24 threads on the 13700K versus 12 and 20 on the 12700K. And finally, 14 cores and 20 threads on the 13600K versus 10 and 16 on the 12700K. Okay, so looking across this famous tech chart, you can see all of the things across the board for every one of the CPUs in terms of the announcement. And you can see that everything got a buff, and a couple of things stayed the same, and then there's a nerf, and we'll talk a little bit about that here in a second. Now, we already talked about the cores and the threads that they got buffed, but the P-cores and E-core boost clocks went up, as did the L3 cache as well. Along with that, the base wattage stayed the same, not that anyone thinks about that number, and unsurprisingly, the turbo number went up. Now, it's worth noting that the base clocks across the board went down, and not insignificantly either. Again, it's really hard to gauge impact without any testing and seeing what it actually means, but theoretically, it means that it really isn't gonna matter all that much for gaming unless you're like running your PC on the sun, AKA it's clocking down because of heat. Now, numbers aside, there is some interesting claims that Intel has made about performance. And let's just be clear, folks, unlike the Ryzen 7000 series, which is kind of proof of what I'm talking about, none of this is real until we get to test it. I mean, AMD had some bold claims, and I think now we're kind of seeing where Ryzen 7000 is. So here's the deal, and I'm not saying that I want to be like a Debbie Downer, but more because I want you to make the decision to spend your hard-earned money on proven performance and not promise. So in this case, Intel is claiming about 15% in single-threaded performance and a whopping 41% in multi-threaded performance, which if the multi-threaded performance is true, we could see some spicy competition in some of those workload benchmarks when it comes to review time in October. And with that power doesn't necessarily mean more power, though from this chart they showed earlier, there is more power, but it's also improvements in efficiency. Now, if you look at this chart they provided on scalable performance per watt, what they say is that with multi-threaded performance that at 65 watts, they were able to get the same performance as a 12900K at 240 watts, which if true, is impressive. And like I said, could be trading blows with the 7950X at release, which honestly, that was probably the part that nobody was expecting to be close, if it ends up being true. Now, the single-threaded performance, if we go back and look at our previous video that you should wait to buy Ryzen 7000 series, we talked about what kind of uplift the 12900K would need to potentially beat the Ryzen 7000 series, and that was 10 to 15% in single-threaded uplift, which right now, it's looking like that's within the realm of possibility. The funny thing is, and I gotta call out Intel on this bit, but if you look at this chart calling out leadership gaming performance, I mean, this looks pretty good for Team Blue, but do you see those random dark orange, like almost hard to see rectangles? Yeah, that's a benchmark too. Those are actually the performance of that pesky Ryzen 7 5800X 3D, the rogue agent from AMD that seems to be disrupting not just Intel's gaming performance claim, but also AMD's. Seriously though, cache is gonna be the name of the game, and in this case, the performance of AMD's 3D cache, and what you're seeing here is from the 5800X 3D. Now lastly, and then after this I'll jump into the comparison, we also had the announcements of the new platform in the Z790 motherboards from Intel, and now we're seeing them pop up via Asus, etc. Now to be clear, they aren't necessary. You can use basically any older Z690 and B660 motherboard with Intel 13th Gen once your BIOS updates are out, which apparently is already happening. But there are some things worth noting for people who may want to upgrade to Z790, and that's specific to gamers, and it's going to be for folks who want a lot of NVMe SSDs. I mean, you may have a massive, you know, massive Steam catalog and you want to put them all. So if you want to basically have a ton of NVMe's that are Gen 4 and make sure they're running at optimal performance, then Z790 might be an option because it adds more PCIe Gen 4 lanes and it's got another 20 gigabyte per second port. Oh, and it's 100 higher. To be honest, if you don't fit that criteria, then you can largely ignore the new platform, except for maybe aesthetic, you might see something there. There were some pretty ugly Z690 boards. So if you're looking for something potentially prettier, hey, maybe you'll find a belle of the ball. So to be really clear, it's not gonna be getting any additional performance. Now, with the backwards compatible nature of Z690, this also means that you get to use DDR4 with Raptor Lake or 13th Gen as well, which given that 13600K's new hotness is gonna make the price of entry for Intel much lower. On paper, Intel looks very good for entry-level builders, but we'll definitely confirm that once we have it on the bench and test it. So now that you have the full picture, the full meal deal, though one is proven and the other is just what a landscape looks like until we can basically proof of concept, let's talk about pros and cons. So let's talk about pros on the AMD side. If you're going to move to Ryzen 7000 series, you're going to be moving to a platform that AMD promises to support until 2025. At least that's the promise. Like we pointed out in the other video, and Linus pointed out as well, they have gone back of that. And I'm not saying that they lied, but in the end, sometimes you just gotta do what you gotta do to make sure you stay ahead. Also, power and efficiency is going to be probably better here. It looks like it's going to be that way given the TDP and everything else and what we've actually tested. I mean, just even on paper, I don't understand how all of a sudden we'd be surprised that Intel's performance, power was just all of a sudden way better and efficiency. Now, cons on the AMD side is you're gonna be paying a premium to upgrade to 7000 series because of the lack of backward compatibility. I know, but they had to ditch AM4 at some point. And also, you're gonna need a quality cooler, even on the lower end. What I will say though, is that there may be some relief coming with the B650 platform later, but how much is unknown, like so many things that you're gonna hear about here. Lastly, the heat is a thing, and it's not fully understood yet, but both your idle and underload temps are higher. And this does have an impact, in fact, a measurable impact on the temperature in some rooms, depending on where you have your PC, and that means cooling and cost. Now let's talk about pros on the Intel side. For sure, we're looking at cheaper across the board, both to jump in from the beginning or upgrading from an existing point. DDR4 and the lower cost all the way down the stack of chips is gonna mean getting into the generation on Intel less expensive than Ryzen as it stands right now. Though we don't know the real world performance of the hardware increase, it does have faster clocks across the board and also more threads and cores in some cases along the stack. What that means is a mystery, but it's still a pro because the number is actually higher. Now, cons on the Intel side is that this is the end of life for this socket. And so that means that with Meteor Lake, we're gonna be looking at another new socket, and like what those folks are going through with AM5, you're definitely gonna have a higher cost next round for Intel to jump into Team Blue with the increased cost, just like the Ryzen folks are doing with Ryzen 7000 right now. It also looks like power is up there, and it's still worth noting that you do have that lower base clock if you're gonna be gaming in Death Valley. Now for the unknowns. We don't really know what the uplift or performance gap is right now between the two, and we won't know until Raptor Lake launches in late October. We also don't know thermally what's actually gonna be happening with Intel 13th gen. See, the thing is like there's some pretty crazy stuff that's coming out via some of the added new stuff that's coming out on Intel's YouTube channel and stuff, and overclock is being pushed here. And the importance of tuning using XTU has been a big part of the hype coming out from Intel. That theoretically means you need to have thermal headroom and power to push the CPU, and maybe that does mean a cooler chip? We just don't know. Let's talk about Team Red. What are the things that we don't know? Well, first thing we don't know is how much things are gonna get better as Ryzen as a platform matures. Chipset drivers, microcode updates, delidding, so many things are being learned right now about these chips as they come out that the outcomes of performance boost or whatever are completely unknown. Now, Ryzen is going to start getting better as more people use it and the platform refines. Now, I absolutely think that we will see improvements just like we did with Alder Lake, but I can't say that I'm expecting the same thing out of 13th gen because it's a really heavily already like refined Alder Lake, P cores, E cores. A lot of that new has already been figured out. And now we're kind of watching that engine purr the way that Intel meant it to. So where does that leave us? Well, it leaves me in the same place it left me this morning when I did my whole should you upgrade video. See, we still don't know enough with this announcement to make a good decision yet on which way to go. See, right now I have to say, it does look really good for Intel, but I think AMD may actually have another ace up its sleeve in November with the RDNA 3 launch. See, AMD is like appropriately positioned to use some of its exclusive technology and synergy to help boost gaming performance with pairing an AMD CPU and GPU together. Like the surprise of smart access memory with RDNA 2, yes, I know that everybody can use it now, but we could see something like that in the future. Now, we actually have a launch date and a price for the Arc GPU. Yay, and maybe that's something that we'll see later on, but it's just beginning. So that feels a far way off and far thing for us to consider. We think about this right now. So here's the deal. If you'll be patient, at least wait until late October when we have reviews for this, but if you could wait for early November, I think you'll find yourself in a much happier place when you jump into any bandwagon at that point in time, because you'll know, hey, did we actually get some sort of surprise thing? Or did we not? You know, that could have completely just been Roby's conjecture. Same thing with, we'll know how much this and how well this actually performs. Like I said in the other video, I do believe that we are far from a tech shortage, and both Intel and AMD should have I think, no issue keeping up with demand, even if you were to purchase things right up until the holiday season. Okay, so there you go. But what are your thoughts? Is there something I missed? Is there something else I should have covered? You know what? I'd love you to tell me your thoughts, and you know what? You could potentially win a little cash in the process. First and foremost, you need to leave a quality comment down below along with liking and subscribing to the channel. Now, when I say quality comment, it doesn't need to be positive. It just needs to be something you either liked or didn't like about the video. What surprised you, etc., about the information I shared, the Raptor Lake announced, what I've compared to with Ryzen 7000? Just not, you know what? I deserve to win. Can I have one of these free CPUs or anything else weird or lame? You also need to ensure we have a way to reach you via your YouTube profile. This is important. So like your email, because if you don't put your email in your YouTube profile, we won't be able to notify you, because we're giving away $25 to one lucky comment below that is worldwide. That means anywhere in the world, as long as you can accept PayPal or Venmo. Now, if we don't have your email in your YouTube profile, we can't tell you you've won, and therefore you can't win. And we're not gonna use your email for anything else, just to tell you you've won. We're not putting you on a mailing list. So, with all that said, what do you think about Intel's Raptor Lake announcement? Are you leaning one way or the other? Are you Ryzen, or are you thinking Intel? Are you gonna wait, or did you pre-order or order your CPU already? And which CPU are you rooting for, if any? Would love to know all that and more down in the comments below. Now, while you're down there, make sure you slap that subscribe button, whip that like button, and ring that notification bell so you get a notification each and every time we post a new video right here on Robitech. Did you know we have a live stream channel for special builds and events? In fact, we're gonna be building both of these very, very soon, this week, on both 13th Gen and Ryzen 7000. So make sure that you head down in the description below and hit that like and subscribe so you don't miss when we build awesome builds like that. Now, do you have questions about 7000 series or 13th Gen or any other tech-related questions? Then check out our amazing Discord server over at discord.gg/robitech, filled with other tech and PC enthusiasts that would love to share your thoughts and their thoughts and ideas on these very subjects. Are you looking for cheap tech, or maybe when CPUs become available or anything like that? Then check out @robitech.com or @RobitechDeals on Twitter. We have our guy Tom scouring the internet for the best deals in all things from PC components to TVs to video games to CPUs, you name it. Now, finally, you can follow me and my entire team on all the other socials @Robitech absolutely everywhere. We hope you really did enjoy this video, and we look forward to seeing you on the next one.